Well, welcome CV to Sunday morning. It's the 29th of November. We're nearly in December. I don't know about you. I've got an unwritten rule that Christmas stuff doesn't start until the 1st of December. So I'm not cracking open the songs yet. The Christmas tree's still in its box. I know some of you have gone down that route already, and hey, I hope you've had a good week. If you're new, then welcome. My name's Jim, and I'm one of the leaders here at CV. And we've got a packed hour for you, again, where we can get into worship, we can get into the scriptures, and we can reconnect online as a community and with each other and with God. Hey, this morning I felt prompted this week to make the walk up to the monument here at the top of the city centre. And I don't know what it's about, but I think it's something to do with perspective. I think that God is telling us or encouraging us, if we can, in this funny old year that we're having, is to get our eyes up and to look around and to see what's out there. Becca and I have been catching up with Joe and Sarah on a regular basis in our community, and one of the things, or one of the CV values that we're really conscious of at the moment, is the value of dependence and how dependent we are on our Creator. And to get us through a year like this, we found that there's absolutely no shame or no problem with admitting quite how dependent on God we are. And in some ways it's brought us to our knees, in some ways it's been a new experience, but getting into regular rhythms of praying together, regular rhythms of catching up with our friends online, has been so helpful for us. And if you're not in a community, I'd encourage you to do the same. One of the things that's really been helpful for me over the last few weeks is an app called Lectio 365. You may have heard of it, you may have it on your phone. If you're not aware of it, then take a look. It's a little app from the 24/7 prayer team, and each morning you can log into that and it will give you a 10-minute devotional to start the day. One of the phrases that they use in there is the one of regathering the scattered senses that we have, and all too often you can go through a day, I go through a day and realize that, well, hey, my senses are so scattered and so torn apart, I suppose, by life and what it throws at you. And so I think let's take this morning, and if we can, pause, breathe slowly, and let God regather our scattered senses as we worship Him. Catch you guys soon.
Thank you. The first notice this morning is a doozy. HMP Rochester has gotten in contact with us through Love Christmas and have requested gifts for 650 of their inmates. Now, they have asked specifically that we would provide a pair of socks for each of the inmates, and that they would all be exactly the same. And they have also asked if we would wrap them. I think it would be great, and I have gotten approval, if we could include anonymous notes of Christmas wishes with each pair. Now, 650 is a big number, and it's more than we are as a church. But I think we can pull this off. And so what we're asking you to do is just one of a few things. Perhaps you want to donate financially to this. That's great. It's not necessary, but it is something that if you want to do, you can do. Just note that in the reference of your donation. The second thing is we need help wrapping all of these socks. So would you be willing to take 50, 60 of these socks and wrap them? That would be brilliant. The final thing is we have asked our kids department to have our children write these notes anonymously with well wishes and kingdom wishes in these notes for these inmates. I would invite you to join in. 650, as I said, is a lot of socks and a lot of notes. So if you would be willing to do 10, 20, 30 notes and drop those off, we would love it. So I think we're all going to have to pitch in here in order to cover this, but it's a simple thing that I think could make a big difference. And what I would love is that each person, as they wrap each pair of socks or write the note for each wrapped pair of socks, would just simply pray a little prayer of God's blessing and for God to reveal himself to this person who obviously is in a very dark place right now. So if you want to be involved in this, we want to invite you to simply email admin@canterburyvineyard.com, and we will let you know where the drop-off is. We're still organizing that at this point. But we need a lot of people fairly quickly to mobilize for this one. Thanks, guys. Just a brief heads up for those of you who want to be involved in the Aylsham project, that they are now needing your gifts by 5th of December. And there's the link to get involved, 5th of December now. The next notice is in regards to City Impact. These gorgeous Christmas cards have been created by Lucy Webborn, and I think you'll agree with me that they are high quality and lovely. And she is offering these at £1.50 per card, with all proceeds going to City Impact. And I think that's brilliant. Lucy says this: the cards are all £1.50 each, and the proceeds will go towards City Impact and the upcoming projects at the Archbishop's School. That will hopefully go ahead sometime in the near future, some of which are very personal to my heart. That's brilliant. So there is a Facebook listing that's right below right now. And there is also an email address that will be in the comments right now for you to be able to make an order for these cards. So you just Facebook message or email with your name, address, and how many of each numbered design you would like. And Lucy says she'll get them to you via Santa's elves, one way or another. So that's brilliant. Thank you, Lucy. And they really are gorgeous. So if you want to kind of get two birds with one stone and support City Impact while giving cards to your loved ones who you may not be able to see in person or even just your neighbors, then make use of these cards. It's brilliant. Thanks, Lucy. Also, we want to let you guys know, as we did last week, about Friends International in Canterbury. There are loads of foreign students who won't be able to go home for Christmas. And there are three ways that you could help by just connecting with one of them. You can do so over Zoom. You could go for an outside walk with one of them. Or host a meal or afternoon tea in a setting that's COVID safe. We would love to be able to have you host one of these. Just get in touch with Biba, and the information is here on the flyer you see right now. And finally, the community fridge at the Hub Cafe, which is hosted by Canterbury Baptist Church, is providing free food parcels for families in need. If you want to help with packing or delivering, just get in touch with admin@canterburyvineyard.com and we'll pass your details along to the Baptist Church so that they can get you on the rota to be able to help as they provide meals for families that are suffering during this time. Thanks, guys.
Your kingdom breaking through. free. Open the heavens, rain down on me, fall down on me.
Happy Sunday to you, or whenever you're watching this. It's good to be with you again, and it's good to be able to open the scriptures together. We're going to look at this ongoing series we're doing called The Jesus You've Never Known. And what we're trying to get at with this series is see Jesus with eyes that maybe we've never used, to see him afresh and to see what makes him so incredibly compelling, interesting, powerful, significant. He's the most important person who's ever lived. And he's changed everything. And maybe we're overfamiliar, or maybe we're underfamiliar. But in this journey, my hope is that we get some fresh perspective on how incredible he is. And what I want to do this week is I just want to jump off of what we were doing last week. So last week we looked at Luke chapter 4, verse 18, where Jesus announces that he has come to bring good news, that he has come to proclaim rescue and liberation and healing and freedom. And in so doing, what Jesus is introducing us to is the main subject of all of his preaching. It's called the kingdom of God. Now, the kingdom of God is a term that is biblical. It goes all the way back to the book of Daniel, but it also is a metaphor. So we can use other things. And later on, I do want to define and to describe what it is. But to begin here, we'll just stay with that metaphor of the kingdom of God. And what I want to point out to you here is something Jesus does. So what is the nature of this kingdom? What's this kingdom like? Well, in verse 19, Jesus says something really interesting. And why it's interesting is because it's what he doesn't say. Now just look at this with me. Luke chapter 4, verse 19. Jesus says, ends his announcement this way: to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. What's interesting is that the verse from the Old Testament that Jesus is quoting here is Isaiah 61, verse 2. And he's only reciting the first half of verse 2. Let me read to you all of verse 2. To proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God. Jesus has intentionally left out the second half, which speaks of the day of vengeance of our God. Now, that's a heavy subject. And like Jesus, what I'm going to do is I'm going to set that aside for another moment, and I'm going to point out the significance of him quoting the first half. Why did he only quote that bit? Because that describes what Jesus' mission is now. You see, this is the moment of good news. When he says, proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, what he's saying is that I am initiating a period of time, however long that may end up being, where my favor is what I'm bringing to the world. I want my kids back. And I am coming on a mission of rescue. And I am coming on a mission of love. And I am coming on a mission of reconciliation and rescue. Jesus is saying the first half of that verse because that's the bit that he's about right now. The rest, that's at the end of time. But right now is the year of the Lord's favor. In John 3:16 and 17, Jesus describes this with some different words. And I want you just to look at that well-known verse with me for a second, okay? Verse 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whosoever believes in him, they're not going to perish. but they will have eternal life. Now listen to verse 17. For God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world. There will be a time of judgment. That is not now. Jesus has come to say, whatever you've done, just come home. Whatever's gone wrong, just come home. The door is open. You're welcome. We want you back. We miss you. We love you. Come home. But that the world might be saved through him. So not judge, but save through him. Not judge, save. Now, for a lot of people, they're troubled with the idea that they need saving. And the language here is clear. We're all in a broken place. This experiment in being our own saviors is not working. And Jesus is saying, I've come to rescue you from that mess. Not to judge you for getting it wrong. And so if we want to take the next step, what we understand from this is that this kingdom of God that Jesus is announcing is the expression of God's love. It is not about judgment. It is about love. This is the mission he is on. It is the year of the Lord's favor. Now, will you respond? And if you have responded, do you understand what a gift you have been given? You see, because if God so loved the world, I can trust him with my life. I don't have to fight him for control of my life. I can do what he says with complete confidence that it is a good thing. See, his goodness compels me towards him, towards obedience, towards his kingdom. He is both glorious and good. And what a kingdom it is. So with that in mind, I just want to ask you a quick question. Understanding that he has come to save, not judge, that he so loved the world, so loved the world. It's interesting. Those are Jesus' words. He so loved the world. He is trying to convey to us the thing that words cannot convey, the immensity of the love of God that has driven him to this action of rescue. So the kingdom must be something really exciting, something to be thrilled about. In Matthew 13, verses 44 to 46, Jesus tells us two little quick stories that illustrates this. All of Matthew 13 is about parables. But these two stand out because they're saying something very specific. Let me read it to you. Verse 44, the kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. When a man found it, he hid it again, and then in his joy went and sold all he had and bought that field. In his joy. When he found this treasure, which is an illustration of the kingdom of God in this parable, he sold all he had, gladly, with joy, in order to get that treasure. And then in verse 45, the second one, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant looking for fine pearls. And when he found one of great value, he went away and sold everything he had and bought it. So I've got a question, okay? And it's for me, it's for you. Are we excited about the fact that the kingdom of God is at hand? That it is currently the year of the Lord's favor? That this kingdom that Jesus describes in Luke chapter 4, verses 18 and 19, that he says, is now begun in your hearing? Does that thrill us? And if not, my question is, why not? See, we have to just take a second and we have to stop. And we have to realize that the way the scriptures talk about the kingdom is meant to be reflected by the way we talk about the kingdom.
This is a day I've been looking forward to for 2.5 years. Every once in a while, a revolutionary product comes along that changes everything. And Apple has been, well, first of all, one's very fortunate if you get to work on just one of these in your career. Today, we're introducing 3 revolutionary products of this class. The first one is a widescreen iPod with touch controls. The second is a revolutionary mobile phone. And the third is a breakthrough internet communications device. So, 3 things. A widescreen iPod with touch controls, a revolutionary mobile phone, and a breakthrough internet communications device. An iPod, a phone, and an internet communicator. An iPod, a phone. Are you getting it? These are not 3 separate devices. This is one device. And we are calling it iPhone. Today, Apple is going to reinvent the phone.
Many of you will recognize the now deceased Steve Jobs there. And what he is doing is he is announcing the first ever Apple iPhone. And the iPhone revolutionized technology. It was a big deal. It still is a big deal. And every year when the new version of iPhone comes out, there's this excitement and this buzz and people wait in line and buy the new one. And my question is this. Is our thrill about the initiation of the year of the Lord's favor? Not judgment. No, that's something else. But right now, the year of the Lord's favor has been initiated. And what does that do to us? All right, the second thing I want to talk about with you guys this morning is, what is the kingdom then? How can we get our heads around it? I want to be excited about it, but I need to understand more of what it is and how it affects my life. Yes, I understood it's meant to rescue, not judge. But what is the kingdom of God? Well, the kingdom is God acting. Now remember, we know some things about God. He is good. He is loving. He is all-powerful. He is all-knowing. He is timeless. But he is love. The very essence of his nature is that of love. And so he is generous and he is kind. So the kingdom is God acting. The kingdom of God is the realm of God's active and effective will. Let me put it another way. It's where God gets his way. And he's a good God. So where good things happen, God is getting his way. There are three kingdoms. Dallas Willard talks about this, and I'm going to show you a clip of Dallas in a moment. But let me just spend a couple of moments. So there's three kingdoms in this world. The first kingdom is the kingdom of God. It is God reigning, ruling. It is present wherever what God wants done is done. It is the range of God's effective will. God's reign is all around you and is from everlasting to everlasting. It is the natural home of the soul. You feel at home in the kingdom. Why? Because you were created for this kingdom. But because God has given free will to his creation, there are two other kingdoms. And the first kingdom is the kingdom of darkness. You see, he's given angelic beings free will as well. And so the kingdom of darkness is the kingdom of Satan, where Satan gets his will accomplished, where what he wants done is done. It is Satan in action, directly or indirectly. See, that's a kingdom we forget about a lot as Westerners. The third kingdom is this. It's the kingdom of me and you. This is the kingdom where what I want done is done. It is what I can do or control directly or indirectly. And our opportunity is to bring our kingdom or queendom underneath God's kingdom, in alignment with God's kingdom, so that what God wants done is accomplished through our kingdom. Get it? Now, the whole idea of the kingdom, like I said in the first bit, is a metaphor. It's an illustration. And with Rome conquering the known world at the time Jesus was preaching here, the kingdom was a very vivid illustration. But perhaps some other illustrations might help you understand this. First of all, something you and your family deal with on a daily basis is the idea of Wi-Fi, the kingdom of Wi-Fi. Maybe in your home, like in my home, when the Wi-Fi goes out, the terror rises. You see, you're left without all of the things that are dependent upon that connection to the World Wide Web. And when that comes back on and the Wi-Fi once again fills the air, connectivity happens. And because of connectivity, all of these things are now accessible and empowered and enabled. And so maybe we can talk about Wi-Fi of God, bringing his heart and his character and his purpose to the world. See, this is what we're talking about when we're talking about the kingdom of God. We're talking about the influence of God and his value system in his heart and his purpose in the world. And here's the thing. This is good news. This is good news. Because he is a good God. His rule and reign is something that we want in the world. So in June, when Black Lives Matter as an issue exploded into a worldwide phenomenon, it was obvious that the kingdom of God was breaking in. You see, because racial reconciliation and racial justice is a manifestation of God's character and therefore a manifestation of his rule and reign and kingdom. So where there is injustice or racial prejudice, that is the presence of another kingdom. But where there is the healing and the justice, then we see the kingdom of God begin to rule and reign in that setting.
And what we have to understand is that the kingdom of God is simply God's ruling. It's his ruling. It's his governing. That's the kingdom of God. And what Jesus came to preach was not that there is a kingdom of God. What Jesus came to make available was entry into the kingdom of God. See, when you see the record of his message is never, there is a kingdom of God. Well, people would have looked at him like he was an idiot. I mean, yeah, what else is new? Everyone knew there was a kingdom of God. They knew that. And they were looking for it to come as a political reality on earth because they had confidence that the promises of God to the Jewish nation would be fulfilled. That's why they were sure that it was going to come. That's why every so often you'd have a bunch of people get up and get an army and say, let's go do it now. The basic reality of the kingdom of God is simply the person of God and the instrumentalities by which he rules. And if we had time, we could talk about those instrumentalities. They are, of course, God's own direct action. They're his spirit. They're his son. They're his word. They're angels. That's why, you see, God is called Lord of hosts over and over in the Old Testament. Was because he was recognized to have this incredible army of angels. The hosts were angelic. There are probably more angels than there are numbers. There's a whole lot of them. There are a lot of numbers too, aren't there? But still, that's the nature of God, is to create at that level. And there's the church. There's other people who are godly people who serve God. Those are all part of the kingdom of God. And then, of course, there's your kingdom and mine. And the biggest threat to the kingdom of God in my life is my kingdom. And then there's a kingdom of darkness. And these three kingdoms are what make up the scene of battle in human life. And when you look at all the terrible things on earth, you say, why are those people in the Sudan doing that to those other people in the Sudan and so on? You have to understand that these are kingdoms that are carrying out the will of human beings, or darker agents still. And the will of the human beings and the darker agents are against the will of God. And another thing we need to say about the kingdom before we go on is, it is not in your heart. It ain't there. It's in reality, and your heart is in it, if anything. But there's a people bounce back and forth from saying that it's a political order to it's being just sort of little warm thought in your heart. And it isn't either one of those. It is God reigning. It is God ruling. So those are things we need to make sure that we keep in mind.
Great. Now, I think some of you are going to probably need to listen to that short clip of Dallas a few times to be able to mine all of the wisdom in it. My final section this morning, what I want to do is I want to just take Mark 1:15 and talk about the so what. So what? What do we do? Well, in order to capture that, I want to take you to a verse in Mark chapter 1, verse 15. Okay, this is the introduction of Jesus's ministry in Mark's version of the Gospels. Mark 1:15. Now, I'm going to start in verse 14, actually. Now, after John was arrested and his ministry comes to an end, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God. Now, the gospel, again, it means good news, the good news of God. And this is Jesus's good news. The time is fulfilled. And the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe this good news. As Dallas said in the clip I just showed you, it is not that the kingdom exists that Jesus is making this declaration. It is that the kingdom is now available. It is at hand to draw or come near or to approach. What he's saying is the kingdom is around you. It has broken into human history, it is affecting human history, and it is doing so through all of the agents that God has in play, the Holy Spirit, the angelic, and his church. And it is at hand, meaning anyone can access this good and glad news. It is available, the door is open. Come in. So what does it mean to come in? And he gives us these two words. Repent and believe this good news. And what I want to do in our final moments is just unpack those two words. Okay? Repent and believe this good news. Now, the word repent always has all kinds of religious connotations for people, and I love just tearing those away. It's not about crying on an altar somewhere. Sometimes that's a part of it, sometimes not. The simple meaning of this word in the original language is to change your mind, to stop thinking in one direction and turn 180 degrees and begin to think the opposite. To change one's mind. Dallas Willard interprets this word this way. He paraphrases it. Change everything about the way you think about life. That's good, isn't it? Rethink how you're living your life in light of this opportunity that is before you. What we find so often is this repentance maybe is something that we feel sad about and we act out at a moment in time in our life, but we then fail to actually live the meaning of the word repent, even though we do the actions of the word repent that we think. No, the actual meaning of repent is to think differently, to live 180 degrees differently than you did before the kingdom was in your life. It's meant to touch every part of your life and my life, and the way we think about it, and the way success is defined, and the way hope is accessed, where we get our strength from. That's what the word repent means. And then he says, repent and believe. This is the second half. And that means to place one's confidence in something. And Willard's paraphrase here says this, build your life around this amazing new opportunity. I like to use the image of standing and putting your weight on something, right? So if you don't trust it, you're not really going to put all your weight on it, because if it crashes down and you fall, you might hurt yourself. But if I trust it, I put all of my weight on it. Build my life around this amazing new opportunity. What he's saying is that the kingdom of God is available now. And what I want you to do is change everything about the way you think about life in light of this amazing kingdom of God, and begin to think about your life differently and build your life around what this kingdom now delivers into your life and how it directs your life. So what the kingdom delivers and how the kingdom directs is now the measure of my life. Now, belief, I described it with stepping on and putting your weight on something. And that's a really important thing, because this doesn't all happen up here. Sure, repentance means to change everything about the way you think about life. And to believe means to build your life around this amazing new opportunity. But there is an important facet of building our life around this amazing new opportunity that includes more than just how we think and how we plan, but how we act. The Hebrews, the Jews, the nation of Israel, would have been befuddled by the idea that we would say we believed something if we didn't then choose to act on that belief. It would just blow their minds. They wouldn't understand it. It wouldn't make sense to them. You don't believe it if you don't try to do it. You just don't. You see, belief and action are interlinked. It's the same thing. To say you believe is to say, yes, you have an inner conviction, but also you have an outer action that is necessary to that inner conviction, or the inner conviction doesn't really exist. You see, to live in the kingdom, first of all, through repentance and then through belief, looks like a transformed perspective, transformed expectations, and transformed actions. Okay? A transformed perspective, transformed expectations, and transformed action. Dallas Willard again tells an amazing story. Tells an amazing story of a woman whose mother suffered a horrific crime. And in the courtroom, this older woman, whose mother was very, very elderly, stood up to give the victim's statement with the convicted, who was the perpetrator, in the courtroom right there. Now, this woman happened to be a part of Dallas Willard's church fellowship. And Dallas and his wife Jane had been praying for her for this episode. And she stood up in the courtroom and she said to the young man, I believe the young man's name was Billy, as Dallas tells it. She said, Billy, you can look at me. Because his head was hung in shame. Billy, you can look at me. I'm not going to be cruel to you. And then she began to share about her faith in Christ, and that because of Jesus and his role in her life, she was choosing and extending forgiveness to Billy for what he had done. And Dallas tells it this way. He says that when she uttered those words, a lightning bolt of the kingdom of God flashed through that courtroom, and the kingdom was made manifest. You see? When we have transformed perspective and transformed expectations that lead to transformed action, the kingdom manifests in the real world. Now, it's real. It's there. But there's something powerful that God intended when we take our will and surrender it to his heart. The kingdom explodes into existence. Wherever we carry or support or release the realities of Luke chapter 4, verse 18 that we studied last week, then we are releasing and exploding the kingdom into our city and our neighborhoods and our area of influence. And this is the exciting thing. He's invited us to play this role of hosts to his kingdom on earth as it is in heaven.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won. For you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. And still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never. Your hands, this is my confidence. never fail me. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me, yeah. You never fail me. You never fail me. I've seen you move. You move the mountains, and I believe. I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way. And I believe, I'll see you do it again. I've seen you move the mountain. And I believe, I'll see you do it again. You made a way where there was no way. And I believe, I'll see you do it again. Your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail me. Sing, sing, the Lord is our deliverer. Sing, sing, the Lord is our deliverer. Sing, sing, the Lord is our deliverer. His love will never fail. His love will never fail. Sing, sing, the Lord is our deliverer. Sing, sing, the Lord is our deliverer. Sing, sing, the Lord is our deliverer. His love will never fail. His love will never fail. His love will never fail. His love will never
fail. That song just nails it. You are no longer on your own. You might have felt like an orphan at times in your life, but you are now a child of God. Your very identity has been changed because God has taken you out of the kingdom of darkness and put you in the kingdom of the Son He loves. And you are now beloved. And you are no longer alone. And you no longer don't know what to do. Because this kingdom carries the heart of God, the heart of love. And you no longer don't know if you have enough strength or resources to follow through on those things that you want to see happen. Because the kingdom of the Creator of the universe Himself lives through you. And its resources empower your obedience and your life and your purpose. I mean, it changes everything. And I just want to close by praying into two things. I want to pray for a growing awareness of the kingdom for all of us, that we might no longer try to do this in our own juice, in our own strength, And I want to pray then, as that awareness grows, that the very presence and the priorities and the values and the purpose of the kingdom begins to beat in our heart and flow through our lives. So let's just pray. Lord, we ask you that your kingdom would become more than an idea, but that it would be what it is, a living reality in which we are now immersed. We're just not aware of it. And I ask you, by your Holy Spirit, that awareness would rise. And the fact that everything is now different would rise in our understanding. And as the awareness grows, Lord, we pray for the power and the resources and the heart of this kingdom to begin to move through our lives, so that the things that you want to see done in this world are done as we surrender to your heart in your kingdom. So Lord, we ask that the good news would be communicated to those who are broken. We ask that the brokenhearted would be healed and comforted. We ask that the captives would be liberated. Lord, we ask that the blind would see, and we ask that those who are oppressed would know freedom and justice. Let your kingdom come. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And Lord, use us, your kingdom kids. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Have a great week, guys.